الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد. So as the brother already explained, the importance of benefiting from the inheritance of the prophets, the ulama, the people of knowledge. So without any delay, I'd like to pass it over to them. And the two scholars that we have with us today are both from Al-Madinah. They are both from the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And both of them teach in Al-Masjid Nabawi. The first speaker, inshallah, that we will have, who's sat on my right, is Shaykh Muqbil Al-Harbi, hafidhahullah, who teaches in the Ma'had of Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi, and also he teaches in the faculty of Hadith in the Islamic University of Medina, especially supervising over masters and PhD students. So, with that, without any delay, I'll pass it over to the Shaykh for the tafadhul mashkur and majoor.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهديه واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فأرحب بكم في هذا اللقاء مبتدئا بالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. والله أسأل أن يجعل لقاءنا هذا لقاء خير وتذاكر في الخير، وأن يجعله لقاء مرحوما وتفرقنا بعده تفرقا معصوما، وأن لا يجعل منا أو معنا شقيا ولا محروما.
The Shaykh starts off by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he begins by welcoming all of you to this gathering today. And he starts this gathering by giving the greetings of Islam to all of you. And he says, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And then he makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he says that I ask Allah to make this gathering a gathering of goodness. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower this gathering with His mercy. And for it to be a means that when we leave this gathering for our sins to be forgiven, and that I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to make any of us from those who are wretched or those who are deprived from goodness.
وهذا الدرس سنجعله من باب المذاكرة معكم، فإننا نتذاكر العلم والحديث في هذا اللقاء إن شاء الله جميعا، ولن يعني أنفرد بالحديث دونكم. فأول ما نبدأ به يعني موضوع هذا الدرس وهذه المحاضرة، وهو أن الله تبارك وتعالى ما خلق الخلق إلا لأمر عظيم، وهو عبادته سبحانه وتعالى. قال الله تعالى: وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. وعبادة الله تبارك وتعالى هي الغاية من خلق الإنس والجن جميعا.
And this lesson that we have today, it is more of a revision lesson where we will just revise some of the teachings of Islam, and then we go through what is mentioned within the Quran and likewise what is mentioned within Hadith. So the first thing that I want to mention regarding our topic today is the foundation of everything, which is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, and that is to worship Him alone. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created jinn or mankind except to worship Me alone. So therefore the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the reason why he subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. It is our purpose in life, and it is the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created jinn and mankind.
وَنَزَلَ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى عَلَى رَسُولِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ الْكَرِيمَ الَّذِي لَا يَأْتِيهِ الْبَاطِلُ لَا مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَلَا مِنْ خَلْفِهِ تَنْزِيلٌ مِنْ حَكِيمٍ عَلِيمٍ. وَكَذَلِكَ نجد أن الله تبارك وتعالى تكفل بحفظه، فقال تعالى: إنا نحن نزلنا الذكر وإنا له لحافظون، وكذلك أنزل على رسوله سنة مطهرة وهي وحي من الله تبارك وتعالى. وهذه السنة هي قول النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام وأفعاله وأعماله، فإنها وحي من الله تبارك وتعالى، وتكفل أيضا بحفظها وما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي يوحى. فمن حافظ على السنة النبوية المطهرة وعمل بمقتضاها فإنه قد فاز بإذن الله تبارك وتعالى. عليكم بسنتي، وهذه من آخر وصايا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لأمته.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed upon His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the Qur'an, that book where no falsehood can come to this book and nothing can change this book. It is a book of just the truth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He took it upon Himself to preserve this book, as He says in the Qur'an, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَلْنَا الذِّكْرِ. The verily we have sent down the dhikr, the remembrance, i.e. the Qur'an, وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. And verily we will preserve it. And likewise, not only did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send down the Qur'an, but He also sent down the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which includes his statements, his actions, and everything to do with him, is also a form of revelation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has preserved. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He does not speak from his own desires. Rather, it is a revelation which has been revealed. So therefore, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is also a revelation. And this has also been preserved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, whoever clings on to the revelation, he is the one who will be successful in this life and in the hereafter. And from the last advices of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي. That upon you is to cling on to my sunnah. And this is from the last advices that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave to his ummah.
وفي القرآن سورة عظيمة فيها منهج عظيم، من أخذ به فقد نجح وأفلح وفاز، ومن خالفه فقد خاب وخسر، وهي سورة العصر. يقول الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى: لو ما أنزل من القرآن كهذه السورة لكفت الناس. وقال في مروي عنه في رواية أخرى أنه لم ينزل من القرآن سوى هذه السورة لوسعته بما فيها من الفضل العظيم والمنهج القويم. فمن أخذ بما ورد فيها فإنه أخذ بحظ وافر ومنهج طريق ومنهج قويم.
And within this revelation of the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed a very short and concise surah, but it is a very tremendous surah. And whoever clings on to the teachings of this surah will bi-idhnillah be from those who are successful. And whoever opposes what is in this surah, then he will be from those who are destroyed and those who have lost out. And this surah is a surah which all of you know, Suratu Al-Asr. Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, he said regarding the surah that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was not to send down any other surah apart from this surah, then this would suffice mankind. This would be enough for a person to take as a methodology for him to be successful. The Shaykh said, so in the beginning before explaining the surah, we want to recite and just go through the surah. So who is willing to recite the surah for us?
والعصر إن الإنسان
لا أخرج ذاك الله خيرا. وإذا قرأت القرآن فاستعذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، هذا أولا. ثم تسمي
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر.
يقول الله تبارك وتعالى والعصر، هذا قسم من الله تبارك وتعالى يقسم بالزمان والدهر. الله سبحانه وتعالى له يعني أن يقسم بما شاء من مخلوقاته، والله أقسم بالعصر. فهل يجوز للمسلم أن يقسم بشيء غير الله تبارك وتعالى؟ سؤال. لماذا؟ ما هو السبب؟ لا يجوز لنا أن نقسم بشيء غير الله تبارك وتعالى. ولهذا روى أبو داود والترمذي والإمام أحمد حديثا عن ابن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه وأرضاه أن رجلا قال لا ورب الكعبة، يقسم قال لا والكعبة، عفوا لو قال رب الكعبة كان قسمه صحيحا، ولكنه قال لا والكعبة. فقال ابن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه أني سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من كان حالفا فليحلف بالله، فإن من حلف بغير الله فقد كفر أو أشرك. فلا يجوز أن نحلف بغير الله، لا بالأمان ولا بالنبي ولا غير ذلك من مخلوقات الله تبارك وتعالى، فإنه أو نحلف بالطلاق ونحو ذلك من الأمور، فإنه لا يجوز لنا القسم بشيء من ذلك إلا بأسماء الله وصفاته جل وعلا.
So in the beginning of this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَالْعَصَرْ الْعَصَرْ by time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is starting this surah by taking an oath and swearing by time. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within the Qur'an swears by different things from his creation. So therefore, because within the Qur'an Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he swears by his creation, can, and Sheikh asks this question to everybody, is it therefore permissible for us to also swear by the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The answer is no. And therefore it is not allowed for the creation of Allah, i.e. us, to swear by anything except by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Shaykh mentions a proof of this, which is a hadith narrated by Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi and Imam Ahmad under authority of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard a man say La wal Ka'ba. He swore by the Ka'ba, he took an oath by the Ka'ba. And when Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, a man said this and Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he heard it. But Ibn Umar, he heard this man say Wal Ka'ba, swearing by the Ka'ba, he replied to this person and he said that verily I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that whoever wants to take an oath, then he should take an oath by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And whoever takes an oath by other than Allah, then he has committed kufr or shirk. So therefore, it is not allowed for a person to swear by anything from the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh gave a few examples. It's not allowed to swear by or take an oath by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or by any of the things. And maybe a couple of examples I'll just add on is that we hear a lot, especially in the UK, I swear on mom's life, I swear on things like that, all of this is impermissible. So therefore, it is not allowed for a person to swear by anything or take an oath by anything except for the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his attributes. Okay, another question, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he swears by asr. Question to all of you, what is the meaning of the word al-asr?
الوقت. طيب غيره.
الزمن.
الزمن غيره.
الدهر
غيره.
بين المغرب والمشرق.
نعم، ما بين الظهر والعشي والمغرب العشي. نعم، لأن الله تعالى تبارك وتعالى أقسم أيضا بالفجر والضحى، والفجر وليال عشر، والضحى والليل إذا سجى. فكذلك يعني بعض أهل العلم قال هذا يطلق على هذا الوقت، وبعضهم قال أيضا وقته أو هي صلاة العصر، المراد به صلاة العصر. طيب، ألا يوجد معاني أخرى لهذا الوقت؟ فإن الدهر وهو الزمان، وهو الذي لا يتغير ليله ونهاره، ولا نعرف متى بدأ هذا الدهر ومتى ينتهي، وهو الزمان الذي يعني خلقه الله تبارك وتعالى، وخلق الشمس والقمر والليل والنهار. لكن ينبغي يعني أن نفهم من هذا اليمين أنه هذا القسم بأنه عند الله تبارك وتعالى عظيم، فأقسم الله به. وقد يطلق هذا الزمن وهذا الوقت على عمر وحياة الإنسان، فإن الإنسان حياته تكون في عصر وفي وقت محدد، وإنه سوف ينتهي به الأجل إلى مرحلة أخرى، وهي مرحلة الموت والقبر، ومن بعده البعث والنشور والجزاء والحساب. فهذه الدنيا التي يعيشها الناس مؤمنهم وكافرهم هي مزرعة الآخرة بالنسبة للمؤمن، فإنه يزداد فيها فضلا وعملا صالحا وخيرا كثيرا. ولهذا أقسم الله تعالى بالعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر.
So the Shaykh asked the question that what is the exact meaning of the word al-asr, and the Shaykh mentioned a number of different meanings that the scholars have mentioned. And what we take from this is that whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw by, it is something important or something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to make us understand the importance of. So one of the meanings of al-asr is the time between Dhuhr and Maghrib. Just right in the middle, the salah that we just prayed is the Asr salah. And some scholars have said it's not the whole time, but it's referring to the prayer salat al-Asr itself. And this shows us the importance of this time and also of this salah, and that it's not something that we should leave off. Other meanings of it is al-Dahr or zaman, time, all of time itself. We do not know from when time started or ended, but it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who created all of that, and he controls everything which is in it, and he created all of the creation which is in it. Another meaning of the word al-asr is the lifespan of a person. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by the lifespan of a person, it shows the importance of it, the importance of our life. And Shaykh mentioned how this life is limited, and there will come a time when our life will be taken from us and we will be resurrected, and then we will have to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we will be held to account for our actions. And the people in this life, especially the believers, then this life is a mazra'ah, it is a farm for them, where they plant the seeds of good deeds and righteous actions, and then the fruits of that will be shown to them when they are standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter.
إن الإنسان لفي خسر. قلنا والعصر هو قسم من الله تبارك وتعالى يقسم الزمان دار الوقت. إن الإنسان لفي خسر، هذه الآية ما مكانها؟ أين جواب القسم؟ أين جواب قسم الله تبارك وتعالى؟
So the Shaykh, he said that the first ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, therefore in summary we can say that he saw by time. And then in the second ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, that verily all of man is in loss. Now, in Arabic, if you have a qasam, if you have a verb or a condition like this, there has to be a second part to it. So, where is the completion of this sentence? The Sheikh is asking.
الخسر ما هو ما هي الخسارة؟ أقسم الله تعالى بأن الإنسان في خسارة. ما المراد بها وما معنى الخسارة؟ الخسارة كالخسران والمراد بها أو لها معان كثيرة. فما معاني تلك الخسارة؟
الخسارة هي الخروج من الجنة.
في اللغة؟
خسارة الدين.
الخسران. طيب منها لكن في اللغة ما المراد بها؟ يقول عليه الصلاة والسلام نعمتان مغبون فيهما كثير من الناس الصحة والفراغ. ما معنى هذا الحديث؟ ما معنى مغبون؟ يعني خسر. الذي عنده صحة وفراغ وعافية ولم يعمل فيهما بطاعة الله عز وجل فهو في خسارة، لم يستفد من هذه الصحة ولا من هذا الفراغ في ماذا؟ في القرب إلى الله تعالى بالأعمال الصالحة. فمن معاني الخسران الغبن.
So the Sheikh, he changed the question slightly and he said, okay, the question that we will focus on is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, what's the meaning of إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. What's the meaning of خُسْر here? What's the meaning of being in loss? And there's many different ways to say this in Arabic, خَسَارَة, خُسْرَان, and so on. And what are the meanings of this? Then he gave an example of a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a very famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which I'm sure most of you have heard before, that there are two blessings that many of the people are مَغْبُون regarding, and I'll get back to that word, which is our free time and our health. The Sheikh said, what does the word maghroon actually mean? And he said, it goes back to the word khusr, the same word as in Surah Al-Asr. And what it means in this hadith is that whoever has these two blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where he has free time and he has good health, but then he does not use that good health or that free time in the obedience of Allah or in that which will take him closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he is the one who has lost out.
ومن معاني الخسر ما هو؟ خسارة من معانيها ماذا؟ معانيها أيضا النقص، ومن معانيها الهلاك
والحرمان
وما ذكرتموه سابقا. فالله عز وجل يخبرنا في هذه الآية العظيمة أن الإنسان في خسر. أليس الإنسان له عمر محدد يعيش في هذه الحياة؟ فكل يوم يخسر وقتا من حياته حتى يقرب إلى قبره، أليس كذلك؟ أليس هذا بخسران في الوقت والعمر؟ لكن المراد منه ليس هذا، أن من عمل صالحا بعد الإيمان بالله تبارك وتعالى فإنه مستثنى من هذا الخسران. المؤمن إذا آمن بالله وعمل صالحا فإنه ليس بخاسر، لأن مصيره عند الله تبارك وتعالى الفضل الكبير وهو رضاه والجنة. الإنسان يعمل بطاعة الله تبارك وتعالى وأن يكون على عقيدة صالحة صافية كما جاء بها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ودعا إليها وأخذها عنه صحابته الكرام وسلف هذه الأمة رضي الله تعالى عنهم من التابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان، وأن هذه الأمة ستبقى منها طائفة على الحق لا يضرهم من خالفهم ولا من خذلهم، وأنه ستفترق أمة الإسلام إلى فرق كثيرة. حذر النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام من ذلك، وذكر أن هذه الأمة ستزيد على اليهود والنصارى بفرقة 73 فرقة كلها على ضلالة إلا واحدة، من كان على منهج النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام واقتفى سنته وأثره وأخذ بهديه فإن هذه الفرقة الناجية، وإن هؤلاء القوم الصالحون إلى يوم القيامة. فعلينا أن نتمسك وأن نتشبث بما جاء في سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وما جاء عن الصحابة الكرام في فهم هذه السنة النبوية المطهرة، فإنه قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي، عضوا عليها من نواجذ، تمسكوا بها. فإن الصحابة ليست لهم سنة سوى سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وطريقه، ولهذا لم تحدث في عصرهم ووقتهم الفرق والجماعات.
So therefore, going back to the meanings of the word khusr or khusara or khusran, in the Arabic language, the meaning of this word has many meanings. From them, a deficiency; from them is to be deprived; from the meanings is to be destroyed; and the other answers that some of the brothers mentioned previously. All of these is from the meaning of the word khusr. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the second ayah, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, that all of mankind, they are in this loss, this destruction, this deficiency. And what this ayah would mean is that every single day that we spend upon this earth, we are in a state of loss or destruction or deficiency. And we're just increasing that loss all the way until we reach our graves. However, this is not the case for a believer, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the rest of the surah, He makes an exception, which in simple terms is the one who affirms iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then follows that up with good deeds, then he is an exception to this loss that mankind is in. And in fact, that person will be in the opposite state. Instead of being in loss, he will be somebody who will be profiting by gaining the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ultimately being entered into paradise. Likewise, not only the person who comes with iman and righteous actions, but the one who clings on to the pure tawheed and aqeedah, creed and beliefs that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came with, and what he called to. And likewise, what the sahaba radiallahu anhum took from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what they taught to the people after them. And likewise, the rest of the imams of the salaf. And the Shaykh mentioned a couple of ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He mentioned one hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that there will always remain one group who are firm upon the truth. With nothing will deter them, no treachery from anybody, or no harm from anybody. They will remain upon the truth. And likewise, he mentioned the other hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned how the Jews and Christians before us, they split into a number of different sects. And that this ummah will split into different sects as well, but into more sects than what the Jews and Christians split into. And all of them are in the hellfire. I mean, all of them are in loss, except for one group. And when the companions radiallahu anhum, they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what group is that? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that the group which is safe from the hellfire is that group which clings on to what I am upon today and all my companions radiallahu anhum are upon. So clinging on to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and what he came with, that is the way of salvation. Likewise, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in the famous hadith, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي, that upon you is my sunnah, meaning obligatory upon you is to cling on to my sunnah, وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ مِنْ بَعْدِي, and upon you also is to cling on to the sunnah of the rightly guided caliphs, أَيُّ وَبَكْرُ وَعُمَرُ وَعُثْمَانَ عَلِيُّ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ, عَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِذِ, and cling on to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the sahaba, cling on to them with your molar teeth. And this is how the sahaba radiallahu anhum were. If you were to think about those people who were the opposite of being in loss, they were the companions radiallahu عنهم. And they had nothing. Their religion was nothing except for clinging on to the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And that's why if you look at their lives, you will not find that they split into different sects, or they deviated, or they became misguided.
فاستثنى الله عز وجل من هذا الخسران من يجيب.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he, from this loss, he gave us in this surah a number of exceptions from this loss. What are these exceptions? Who can answer?
المؤمنون من آمن بالله تبارك وتعالى فإن الإيمان هو الأساس الذي تبنى عليه صحة الإيمان صحة الأعمال فلا يصح العمل بدون إيمان أبدا والإيمان تعرفون أركانه وهي أركان ستة تؤمن بالله ملائكته وكتبه ورسله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله وباليوم الآخر وفي القدر خيره وشره فهذه أركان الإيمان لكن أنتم كلكم مؤمنون فمن هو المؤمن؟
So the Shaykh, he says, or the answer, the first answer that was given, or the first people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first 10 people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made as an exception, which is the believers, those people that have Iman. And therefore Iman is the foundation. And without Iman, our actions cannot be accepted and they cannot be correct. And this Iman is based upon 6 pillars that all of you are aware of, which is to have Iman in Allah and in His angels and in His books and in His messengers and to have Iman in the last day and to have Iman in the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the good of it and bad of it. And therefore, generally all of us, bi-idhnillah, we are from the believers, we are from the mu'minun. However, the Shaykh, he asks a question to all of us, he puts a question forth, that who truly is a believer, who truly is a mu'min, what does it mean to be a مؤمن.
لو سألك شخص وقال أنت مؤمن مؤمن تقول نعم أنا مؤمن لكن ما هو إيمان ما حقيقته الذي تجده في نفسك كيف تجيب عن ذلك
If somebody was to ask you a question, are you a mu'min? Are you a believer? Then you say yes, that I am a believer. But if somebody was to ask you, are you a true believer? What is the reality, the true meaning of this iman? Then what answer would you give them? Who will answer?
هذه أركان الإيمان. لكن إيمانك أنت كيف تعبر عنه؟ تفضل.
بالعمل الصالح.
يقين بالله.
نعم غيره.
العمل الصالح.
طيب هو إقرار بالقلب. نعم.
تصديق اللسان.
نطق باللسان وعمل بالأركان هذا الإيمان تقر بقلبك يعني تتكلم بلسانك وتتحدث بلسانك عنه وكذلك تعمل في جوارحك لما جاء في كتاب الله وسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم على هذه الأمور التي ذكرها النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام وذكر الله في الكتاب
No. So what's the meaning of Iman? And our brothers gave different answers, but the summary of the answer is that Iman is that which comprises of 3 things. Firstly, affirmation of this belief in our hearts. And then secondly, we mention that statement on our tongues. And thirdly, we act with our limbs. So we act in accordance to what this Iman necessitates, in accordance to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to do within His book, and likewise in the Sunnah of His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم.
نفهم من هذه الآية أن المستثنى من الخسران الذين آمنوا. ما مفهوم هذه الآية؟
So therefore, if you go back to Surah Al-Asr, all of mankind is in loss إلا الذين آمنوا, except those In the context of this surah, in the context of this ayah, what's the meaning of this part of the ayah? إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا except those that have iman.
من هو؟
Who will answer?
من هو الخاسر في هذا الباب؟
غير المؤمن
الكافر المشرك لئن أشركت ليحبطن عمله ولتكونن الآخرة من الخاسرين. نعم المشرك الكافر عياذا بالله خاسر في الدنيا والآخرة. نعم.
So therefore the الذين آمنوا, those who believe, those that who are believers, and then the opposite of this would be the disbelievers or the polytheists, the kafir or the mushrik. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ, that if you were to quit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah will make all of your actions nullified, and you will be in the hereafter from those من الخاسرين, from those who have lost out.
قال الله تعالى من اتخذ الشيطان وليا فقد خسر خسرانا مبينا.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that whoever takes shaitan as a close friend, that he has lost out a great loss. The same word, khasir.
ثم بعد الإيمان لا بد من العمل الصالح. ماذا قال الله تعالى؟ إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات. الإنسان يجتهد في هذه الحياة ويعمل بطاعة الله على شرع الله وعلى منهج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, ولا يخرج عن ذلك قيد أنملة, ولا يجتهد ولا يبتدع في دين الله ما لم يأذن به الله, لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو مردود عليه. فلا بد من اقتفاء أثر النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام والأخذ بهديه في عبادة الله وطاعته مع توحيد الله والإخلاص له.
And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after this, He mentions the second exception where He says, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, except those who have iman and do righteous actions. Meaning, we have to act upon that iman and that knowledge that we have. Therefore, we have to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and show obedience to Him. And this obedience should be done in accordance to the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the methodology of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We should not, especially when it comes to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obeying Him, we should not move away, not even an inch, from the guidance and the methodology of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Otherwise, it will be rejected from us and not accepted. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in Bukhari and Muslim, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدْ, that whoever does an action which is not from our actions, meaning it's not something that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not do, فَهُوَ رَدْ, and therefore it is rejected and it will not be accepted. So we need to make sure that these righteous actions that we do, that they are in accordance to the methodology and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and likewise they are based upon the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and making that action sincerely for Him.
ومن المفلحين وغير الخاسرين, قال الله تعالى الذين تواصوا بالحق. فمن مراد بالحق؟
So the third exception that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصُوا بِالْحَقِّ, that the third exception are those that advise one another or counsel one another with the truth. The Shaykh, he asks a question, what's the meaning of the truth in this ayah?
Allah Ta'ala Tawheed. نعم. نعم.
الدين. رفض الكتاب والسنة. نعم.
الحق هو التوحيد.
نعم لا شك التوحيد وما يقتضيه التوحيد من العمل الصالح. يوصي بعضهم بعضا ويذكر بعضهم بعضا ويدعو بعضهم بعضا إلى هذا الحق. قال الله تعالى فماذا بعد الحق إلا الضلال.
So the meaning of the الحق in summary is the whole religion. The religion based upon the book of Allah and the sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And therefore the third exception in this surah from all loss and destruction are those people who advise one another and remind one another and advise one another with the religion, with the truth, and with the book of Allah and the sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فماذا بعد الحق إلا الضلال. That there's nothing after the truth except misguidance. So therefore, we need to make sure that we advise one another and help one another to stay upon the truth and not fall into misguidance.
قال الله تعالى وتواصوا بالصبر. فما المراد بالصبر؟
And the fourth
وعلى is... وعلى ما يكون الصبر.
الصبر على الفتن.
نعم. فقط.
على الفتن والمشقة.
كيف يعني الفتن والمشقة؟ نصبر عليها. نبتعد عنها خير من أن نصبر عليها. نعم.
على أداء الناس.
يوصي بعضهم بعضا بالحق ويوصي بعضهم بالصبر. الصبر على فعل الطاعات. ولهذا من يعني نجد أن الصحابة أو بعض الصحابة قال قولة مهمة في هذا الباب وهو أننا يعني صبرنا على الطاعة واجتهدنا فيها لكن الصبر على المعاصي من أعظم الأمور لأنها قد تكون في متناول يد الإنسان ويصل إليها لكن من يوصي نفسه وغيره بالصبر على الطاعات والابتعاد عن المحرمات وكذلك يصبر على ما أصابه من أقدار الله تبارك وتعالى ولا يأخذه الهلع والجزع وأن يعني يلوم نفسه أو يلوم قدر الله عز وجل منهم من يعبد الله على حرف فإن أصابه خير اطمأن به هي الآية فيه كيف؟ ألست بحافظ؟ ها؟ قلبها نعم خسر الدنيا والآخرة لأنه ترك الصبر على قدر الله عز وجل ولم يرضى به فالتواصي بالصبر مهم حتى لا يقع الناس في المعاصي وحتى يعين بعضهم بعضا على طاعة الله وحتى يصبروا على أقدار الله عز وجل
And in the fourth exception that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he says, and they advise one another with patience. So after advising one another and counseling one another with the truth, they advise one another to have patience upon this truth and upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But not only that, not only upon the obedience of Allah, but as some of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they mentioned that we have patience upon the obedience of Allah, but something else which also needs to be given a lot of importance is having patience from staying away from the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is from the greatest of affairs, that a person, when a sin calls him or beautifies itself to him, he has patience and he prevents himself from falling into that which is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also the third thing that a person has patience upon is upon the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when, for example, somebody was to pass away or lose a job and so on, a person, he has patience in those times of difficulty. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran that there are people who when they worship Allah, their worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a concrete or a steadfast type of worship. That if something good happens to them, then they become happy and they become content. But if some trials and tribulations come their way, inqalaba ala wajhi, they turn over onto their faces, meaning they are no longer steadfast upon the religion. As soon as some difficulty comes to them, then they go to the state of being in a state of loss in this life and also that which will cause them to be in a state of loss in the hereafter.
فنسألك اللهم يا مقلب القلوب أن تثبت قلوبنا على طاعتك حتى نلقاك وأن يرزقنا وإياكم العمل الصالح والعلم النافع وأن يرينا الحق حقا ويرزقنا اتباعه وأن يرينا الباطل باطلا ويرزقنا اجتنابه وأشكركم على وقتكم هذا والله أسأل أن يكتب لي ولكم الخير والثواب في هذه الدنيا والآخرة وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
So therefore with this concise understanding of this great surah, we conclude this session and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the turner of the hearts, to keep our hearts firm upon His religion until we meet Him. And I also thank all of you for listening attentively. And alhamdulillah, with that, Shaykh Muqbil Hafidhahullah, he has concluded and finished his lecture.